In the study of manifolds, we introduce the notion of a topological manifold, gave some examples, and then introduce the notion of manifolds with boundary also. And we have also shown that every manifold is paracompact, including the manifolds with boundary. We also showed that the boundaries of a bounded manifold have what are called as Kohler neighborhoods. So today we shall study some homotopical aspects, and one of the key to that is that every topological manifold is a subspace of some large Euclidean space. So that is the meaning of embedding. So every manifold can be embedded inside a Euclidean space. So as such, it seems that we don't have to go out of Rn. We could have taken only subspaces, topological subspaces of Rn with the locally Euclidean structure, like circle or a sphere and so on. Okay, as contrast with the union of two lines and so on. That's all. However, in practice, what happens is manifolds are not occurring or not displayed as a subspace of Rn, some Rn. They come in different forms. Then it is a burden to see them, first of all, that they are subspace of Rn. So the abstract definition has this advantage. Okay. So let us anyway do this embedding, which will itself help in other aspects of the manifolds. The following result tells us that after all, we could have just stuck to the study of subsets of Euclidean spaces for studying manifolds. As we shall see, this single result has several implications on topological, homotopical, and homological properties of a manifold. Being subspaces of Rn is itself something special. Every N manifold is homeomorphic to a closed subset of R2N plus 1. Very specific about it. Start with N, you don't have to go for a very large N, but R2N plus 1 will do. So this is quite tight. There are examples wherein you may not be able to do it in R2N, or even lower than that, and so on. So we should stick to that. Okay. For every topological manifold X, the set of embeddings of X, if you look at all the embeddings of X in just I2n plus 1, okay, is dense in the space of I2n plus 1 power X. What is this one? These are all continuous functions from x to I to n plus 1, out of which you take only the embeddings. So that would be dense. So what is the topology here? This is a compact open topology. Of all continuous maps, this is from x to I to n plus 1, all continuous maps, with topology of uniform convergence on compact subsets, which is the same thing as the topology, compact open topology. Okay, if you want closed embeddings, then you have to take X to be a compact subspace, because if I2n plus 1 is compact, if a closed subspace will be compact. Okay, so this is the result. What I have chosen is not to prove this result. proof is quite lengthy and complicated and not very illuminating. Okay, therefore, we shall only take a very mild form of this theorem only for compact spaces, and we shall be liberal with this I to n plus 1. We shall not bother about I to n, some large n. Okay, so that's what we are going to do. However, here is a reference and so on. The proofs of these theorems are somewhat lengthy and hard. The smooth version of 6.3, you know, if you have a smooth manifold, you can embed smoothly and so on. They are under the name easy Whitney embedding theorems, which are slightly easier proofs also, which you may read from many books, such as my own book on differential topology. However, for the topological case, there are not many references available. You are welcome to see this in an excellent old book by Hurwitz and Allman. I have given their reference here. This is a wonderful book. Or you may choose to read a nice proof of embedding 6.3 from Munkre's book. Okay, there are two Munkre's book I have referred. We shall be satisfied with an easy proof of the following weaker version, namely every compact manifold with or without boundary, that we don't bother, is homeomorphic to a closed subset of some Euclidean space. Some Euclidean space. Okay. So we are not bothered about how large this n has to be taken and so on. Okay, and this result, this part is very easy. Let us see how. X has a chart, okay, an atlas consisting of UIs and homeomorphism phi I, fi from UI to where A is either Rn or Hn. Okay. Since X is compact, there will be a finite cover. So I can assume a UI is 1, 2 up to K. Okay. On each UI, I have a homeomorphism into Rn or Hn, depending upon the point is and the boundary and so on. Okay. Now pick up a inverse for each of them. Pick up inverse eta from Rn to Sn. Sorry, eta from Rn to Sn is the inverse of the stereographic projection. Okay. Sn minus a point to Rn, you have what is called as homeomorphism, is called stereographic projection. Yeah. This eta is the other way around, so inverse of the stereo projection. And let gi from x to Sn be the extension of eta composite fi, which sends the entire of x minus ui to the north pole. See, ui is a homeomorphism, fi is a homeomorphism from ui to, let us say, for the definite test case, Rn. Okay, first. Okay. Then outside ui, we have to send it to the north pole. So for that, you have to take gi as the composite of f eta composite fi. So fi is from ui to a, and eta is from a to Sn. Okay. It already fills the whole space except whole of Sn except a single point. So the rest of you send it to that point. That is a continuous extension automatically. Okay. So these are GIs are continuous function which send x minus ui to north pole. So put g equal to, so I have got some continuous functions. What is the property of these continuous functions? Restricted to each UI, they are one-one mappings, they are embeddings. Okay. But outside your x minus ui, whole of x minus ui is going to a single point. It's very bad there. Okay, but look at g equal to g1 cross g2 cross gk from x to Sn cross Sn cross Sn and k times, which is a subspace of anyway R n plus 1 raised to k. So this sphere is coming in a nice way for us to help. We'll see that. So finally, I have got it a map here. I want to say that this will be an embedding now. All that I have to see that it's already a continuous function because each GI is continuous, and I have taken just an inclusion map here. Okay. All that I have to verify is that GC is what? 1-1. If it's 1-1 mapping, okay, then X is compact, this is Hausdorff, automatically it will be a 1-1, it is a homeomorphism on to the image. The proof will be over. Okay, verify that G is a 1-1 mapping. Okay, this I have left to you, but now I will do that in a short minute. So why this is a 1-1 map, tell me. So how does this fail to be a 1-1 map? How does it fail to be a 1-1 map? So there must be a point x comma y such that g1 of, okay, suppose x comma y is a set g1 cross g2 cross gk of x equal to g1 cross g2 cross gk of y, right? If x and y happen to be in one of these ui, okay, then gi of x will be different from gi of y if x and y are different, because there it is injective. Therefore, they can't be in the same ui. So suppose x is in ui and y is in, it's not in ui. As soon as y is not in ui, what happens to, say, what happens to this one, this definition, extension of this one? Gi of that point will be the north pole. But what happens to xi, which is inside ui? It is eta composite fi. So it is something which is not the north pole. So the image is different. Okay. So now we will use this property. We will use this theorem itself, that every manifold is a subspace of, I know, can be embedded in a Euclidean space. Okay, though we proved it only for compact spaces, we shall use this one for all manifolds. So in order to derive some homotopical and homological properties of manifold, the first thing we prove is the following theorem, and perhaps this is the only theorem, it is the only result that we can prove today. Okay, so have patience because it's slightly longish. Let X be a locally contractible closed subset of Rn, a closed subset of some Rn, and U be an open subset of Rn such that X is inside U. That means this U is a neighbor of our set. What is the assumption on X? It's a closed subset and it's a locally contractible subset. Then there is an open subset V such that X is inside V, contained inside U, and there is a retraction V to X. So this is what is called as, you know, local retracts. In fact, you can say that it's a deformation retract and so on. That is what leads to our co-fibration syndrome. I am not trying to prove such a strong result here. Only retraction. Every subset which is locally contractible is a retract of a neighborhood. That neighborhood can be chosen as small as you please. This is the meaning of this theorem. Okay. So let us see how we are going to do that. So recall our notation and lemma for what are these lattice? We had this lattice structure, remember that, which gave you CW complexes and so on. While proving CW approximation theorem, you have used that one. So let LK denote the lattice points that of all X belong to Rn, such that Xi is some integer Ri divided by 2 power k. the denominators are only 2 power k. Okay. Of course, some 2 may cancel out, it may become smaller than that. So this k is a fixed, k is greater than or equal to 0 is a positive quantity. So it is, these are numbers. Okay, this xi's are n of the capital N coordinates, I ring to 1, 2, 3 up to n. Okay, for all of them, it must be, all the coordinates must be of this form. Okay, rational numbers of the form, ri's are integers, the denominators are only 2 power k. Put L equal to union of all these LKs. So L1, for example, is all the lines, planes, you know, drawn at length, at the interval 1, at all the integer points. L2 will be at half integer points. L3 will be at 1/4 integer points. And so on. Okay? That is the meaning of, you have sharper and sharper lattices are there. That pk denotes the set of all closed n cubes sigma of length, side length 1 by 2 power k. Okay, like 1 by 2 or 1 by 4 and 1 by 8 and so on. Okay, and with corners inside one of the LKs, corresponding LK. LKK is fixed, this pk is those points. Okay, a closed cube. Let p equal to union of pk. I am just recalling all these things which we have done earlier before. We restate a lemma, namely 1.3, for ready use. What was the lemma? That lemma was that take a collection of subsets, a collection of points from p. Say a is a subset of p, such that sigma 1 and sigma 2, what are p? P's are cubes, remember that. Okay. Sigma 1 and sigma 2 belong to A implies sigma 1 is not contained in a sigma 2. Okay. So if we have 1/4 cube and 1/8 cube, that 1/8 cube should not be inside 1/4 cube. It should be maybe adjacent to it and so on. Touching is all right. It should not be contained inside. Okay. Then, if that is the only property, then this WA, which is the union of all the sigma, sigma belonging to A, the underlying topological space, this is the support of all this. Take union of all the sigma belonging to A, it's a locally finite, countable, pure, n-dimensional CW complex with all its N cells being members of A. So come things for coming, all the N cells will be this one. Okay. Indeed, we have seen that this is also a actually can be further cut down into a simplicial complex. A cube, if you cut it into a simplicial complex, then it will extend it to the whole thing. That's all. Since you don't want to cut the cube into triangles and tetrahedrons and so on, so it's a CW complex. Okay. So that is the lemma. That is ready made. Now we directly go to the proof of the theorem. The theorem is what? I have to produce this V as well as R. V is a neighborhood contained inside U, neighborhood of X, and R is a retraction. Okay, so we vote for that one. So let A1 be the union of all cubes in P0. P0 is what? Integer points, right? Side length 1. Now, that in P0 are cubes of side length 1, in P0, contained in U, okay, and which do not meet X. There may not be any, I don't care. Let A1 be the union of all cubes in P0, contained in U, and which do not meet X. Okay. Inductively, for k greater than or equal to 1, let ak be the union of all those cubes in p 1 by 2 power k minus 1. Actually, p, I should just write pk minus 1 in my notation. Pk minus 1, which do not meet x. So I repeat, inductively, for k greater than or equal to 1, let ak be the union of all those cubes in pk minus 1, okay, which do not meet x and contained in u, but are not contained in any member of ak minus 1. If you have already taken some ak minus 1 and things are inside that, you should not take them. So for a1, there was no such problem. Okay, which is a starting point. So for a2, along with the conditions like a1, okay, inductively, I should, if there have been something is larger box has been taken, a smaller box inside that should not be taken. Okay, so that is a definition of ak minus 1. Put a equal to union of all these ak's. Now let w equal to wa be defined as in the lemma. By the very definition that, but not contained in any member of ak minus 1, it will satisfy that this condition of this lemma, namely sigma 1, sigma 2 implies sigma 1 is not contained in sigma 2. No, once a member is taken, a smaller cube inside that will never be taken. So that is why this condition is automatically satisfied. Therefore, we can apply the lemma, W will be defined as in this one, then, okay, Rn minus X, okay, Rn, you have a subset X, right? Rn minus X will be the entire of W, and W has a CW structure in which all these cubes of various sizes form n-dimensional cells. So this part is lemma A. By the very choice, none of these, okay, none of these will be inside, will intersect X. So they are contained inside Rn minus X. But everything in Rn minus X must be inside W, because P1 itself covers it. P1, P2, all the smaller, they will cover the whole thing anyway. Okay. Suppose you have some small set F for X. If you take large, far away integers, the whole cubes will be inside X, inside W, right? So Rn minus X is actually W. This W will be covered by all of that. And W has CW structure. The funny thing is, we are not doing anything for X. The complement of X, very nice structure we have got. The W has CW structure. All these cubes of various sizes, all of them n-dimensional cells. Smaller and smaller maybe, smaller and smaller. Keep coming nearer X, but you know, will not intersect X. Okay, so that is what it is. Now let us see how. We shall construct a subcomplex V of W and a function R from X union V to X. Okay, so X union V would be finally a neighborhood, okay, such that Rx is equal to X on X belong to X. We shall then show that its X union V contains a neighborhood of X, okay, and R is continuous on this neighborhood, which will complete the proof of the lemma. If it contains one neighborhood, then given the open original V, original U, you intersect further with the U and restrict the whole thing. So that is the idea. So X union V, V is now a subcomplex portion of W. X union V has this property. It's what we have to show. And then of course we have to show that it contains a neighborhood of X. Okay, and also I will show that R is continuous on this neighborhood, which will come to the problem. So this is all visual thinking. It takes some time to prove this one. Let us go ahead with this one. First, the constructions of V and R will be done simultaneously and inductively. Okay, later we shall check the continuity of R so defined. Right now, don't bother about the continuity of R. So we have it in mind that it will have to be continuous. That's how we are trying to do that. Okay. Of course, we start with Rx equal to R, because there is no choice. Because it has to be a retraction, right? Onto X. So Rx is X. Take the zero skeleton of V. I am going to define V. Define V. V most will have to be a CW complex, right? To be W0. W is a CW complex. Right? So take the zero cells of W. All these lattice, some of the lattice points will come. Okay, that is all vertices of W. That is W0. Given sigma belonging to V0. So V0 is constructed now. V0 is W0. Choose any point R sigma. So sigma is a vertex. Okay, but I am writing it as if it is a simplex. It is just a V0, it is a vertex. But each point, choose another point inside X such that its distance between sigma and Rx, sigma and R sigma. See, sigma is given. R sigma I am choosing such that it's less than distance between X and sigma. Remember, this sigma doesn't intersect X. They are inside W. So there's a positive distance. X is a closed subset. It's a positive distance. So twice this distance, okay, you take that. That must be bigger than distance between sigma and Rx. This Rx must be a point of X. All right. So there is nothing very great about this one. Here, D denotes the distance between, namely, infimum of the Euclidean distance, dxy. The distance between a point and a space means that. Okay. So the construction of V0 and R on X union V0 is over. The zero skeleton is over. Okay. Now we want to do the one skeleton, two skeleton, and so on. Okay. Actually, here you can easily see that this has to be a continuous function because X on X is identity and V0, which is discrete, you could have taken any function. So, but I will not discuss continuity right now. Okay, let's go ahead. Having defined Vk minus 1 and R from X union Vk minus 1 to X, okay, let us take sigma to be any K cell in W, such that boundary of sigma, which is, you know, sigma is a box. It is a very regular box. The boundary of this will also consist of various, union of boxes, actually, of all over dimension. The boundary must be contained inside Vk minus 1. Okay, let's take sigma to be any K cell of W, such that boundary of sigma is contained inside Vk minus 1. Suppose for V1, suppose two points are already there, then look at one of the cells. So take such a cell, one cell, a line segment. Okay, V0 is just vertices. Now the line segments which belong to these lattice points only, lattices only. It may be of length 1 by 2 or 1 by 3, one by four or one by eight and so on, whatever. Okay. So take such a sigma, such a boundary of sigma is Vk minus one. If R from boundary of sigma to X has a continuous extension, see, R is defined on boundary of sigma already, right? Because boundary of sigma is in Vk minus one. If it has a continuous, I don't know, if it has a continuous extension, then let us put this sigma inside Vk. Something is defined on boundary. If it has continuous extension on the whole of sigma, then that is an ideal thing. You take that test, that sigma inside VK, not otherwise. If you cannot extend it, don't take those cells. Okay, having put this sigma inside VK, take R from sigma to X to be any continuous extension now, which satisfies the property. Amongst all continuous extensions, you must take one. There may be several. You must take one such that distance between sigma and R sigma is less than twice the distance between sigma and R prime sigma. This is the minimal. Take the one which is minimal in some sense. What exactly? I can't do that. So, but I have doubled it and take one of them for all extensions R prime from sigma to X. Okay, I would like to have minimal, but I don't know. So, but take double of that, then definitely this will be less than that. There will be one because given any R sigma, that R sigma itself satisfies this property. So, among the stack, therefore, there must be one, okay, which satisfies this one. Okay, this completes the construction of VK and R from X union VK to X. By induction, V and R are the definition of V and R complete. Okay, it remains to prove a number of things. What we have to do? This V, X union V, contains a neighborhood of X inside Rn, R capital N. Then I have to prove that this R is continuous on that neighborhood. Once you have done that, the proof is over. All right. So let us do that. Note that by very choice, R is continuous on V. Can you see that? What we have done? We introduced a first V naught. On V naught, everything is continuous. On V1, we will take only those sigmas on which we could have extended the already defined sigma on the boundary to a continuous function. And then we took one of those continuous functions, extensions. Okay, therefore, the function R is continuous on each sigma. That is enough for a function to be continuous on the on CW complex. A function is continuous on CW complex if its intersection with restricted to each simplex is each cell is continuous. So that's what we know already. Okay, so we have to verify continuity at the points of X. You see, only for X, it is identity. There it is continuous. That doesn't mean that as a function of X union V on the X union V, why that is continuous. So many people make this mistake. Okay, now it's already because on X it's identity. Restricted to X, it is continuous. But on the space X union V, it must be continuous. And that is the crux of the matter here. Okay. So we must prove verify X continuous at points of X belong to X. Continuity must be verified on X union V. Remember that. So given X belonging to X and epsilon positive, I have put epsilon 2n equal to epsilon. Maybe I can do it with epsilon n. We will check. It doesn't matter. And go on choosing the later ones in the following order. Once you have chosen epsilon 2n, the next one will be chosen such that 3 times epsilon I is less than epsilon I plus 1. Or this one is smaller than one third of the earlier choices. Keep doing it till you hit epsilon naught. Okay, smaller and smaller epsilon have chosen. So that now if Bi is X intersection B epsilon of X, पी एप्सिलॉन आई ऑफ एक्स इज ए बॉल इनसाइड वेयर इन आर एन इंटरसेक्ट विथ एक्स दैट इज बी आई. देन द इंक्लूजन मैप बी आई टू बी आई प्लस वन इज नल होमोटॉपिक. सो हाउ डू यू एंश्योर दिस? दिस इज वेयर लोकल कॉन्ट्रैक्टिबिलिटी ऑफ एक्स इज यूज्ड. दिस इज द मीनिंग ऑफ लोकल कॉन्ट्रैक्टिबिलिटी. Given any neighborhood, you must have smaller neighborhood, okay, such that the inclusion map of that neighborhood in the larger one must be null homotopy. So that is the meaning of this local contract. This is local contractibility of axis. Okay. So I don't say that this epsilon I is exactly 1/3 of epsilon plus one. No, smaller than that. Okay, so that's why you have to choose such a epsilon I. Let ut be bt of x, where 0 is less than t less than epsilon naught by 4. After choosing the last epsilon naught, I am going to further divide it by 4, maybe 3 is enough again, and take t smaller than that. That is my ut. Okay. We first claim that if sigma is any cell of W, you know how the cells of W are taken, contained in this UT, you know, there are maybe very smaller cells, then sigma will be automatically in V, and the distance between X and R sigma, remember that, okay, R sigma was some point, if V was single point and so on. This should be less than epsilon. No, this epsilon looks very big now because we have come so small here. Okay. So this claim is what makes it work like this. So if all these sigmas are inside V, and you know, then the sigma is a cell of W contained in UT. Okay, so that is already in V. So all portions of UT intersection V, they will be inside V. So that is how we can be able to prove that V is open. Okay, suppose A is a zero cell, and A belongs to UT. So we have to prove this one. So I start with a zero cell. Suppose A is a zero cell and A belongs to UT. Then distance between X and RA is less than distance between X and A plus distance between A and RA. Okay. X and A is by definition is UT, so it is T. But this is by definition twice distance between A and X. That was our first choice. Okay. So this is T and this is twice T. So the whole thing is less than 3t, okay, and 3t is less than epsilon naught because t is less than epsilon by 4. So I said that's why this may be, you can assume epsilon by 3t less than that, then it's okay, doesn't matter. Okay, so it is less than epsilon naught. Now suppose for all k minus 1 cells, tau of v contained in UT, we have proved that distance between X and R tau is less than epsilon 2k minus 2. Okay, epsilon 2k minus 2. For k equal to 1, we have proved this one. Okay, k minus 1 cell is 0 cells, we have proved it. Now, inductively, suppose we have assumed this one. By the way, finally we want to prove epsilon, but all these are less than epsilon, right? So epsilon naught was very small, coming all the way down. So once we have this is epsilon naught, then so we are proving inductively. If we just prove epsilon here, then we will not be able to prove the next step. So you have to prove inductively that is less than epsilon 2k minus 2. Let sigma be a K cell of W contained in UT now. Then boundary of sigma will be contained inside B epsilon 2K minus 2. Okay, because we have proved this one. And the inclusion B epsilon 2K minus 2 is contained in the B epsilon 2K minus 1 by choice, because this is less than one third of this one. Okay, and the inclusion map, we have BI to BI plus 1 is null homotopy. That's important, null homotopy. Since there exist extensions R from boundary of sigma to BI, okay, inside BI plus 1, sorry. Once it's null homotopy, if the map is null homotopy, then you can always extend R from boundary of sigma to BI. Okay, so BI to BI plus 1 null homotopy. So you can extend it. So inside BI plus 1, you can extend it. From 37, what is 37? This choice. Okay, it follows that distance between sigma and R sigma will be twice 2k plus 1 epsilon 2k plus 1. This epsilon 2k plus 1. Okay. So twice comes because of our choice is like that here. Okay. Therefore, once again, the same thing as here, D of X R sigma instead of R A is just D of X sigma plus D of sigma R sigma. And this is always T, but this is now twice epsilon 2K plus 1. So this is also less than epsilon 2K plus 1. Sum total is 3 times epsilon 2k plus 1, which is less than the next one, epsilon 2k. Okay. Therefore, by induction, we have R of UT intersection V is contained inside U epsilon. Okay. So, each time you are press 2k, right? So, for each k you have done, so all of them are less than epsilon anyway. So, this is contained inside U epsilon. Okay, note that this, however, does not complete the proof of continuity of X at R, nor does this prove that V contains a neighborhood of X in X. But there is a hope, that's all. We have to prove one more step. For we have not yet proved that UT itself is contained inside V, since UT will necessarily have many points belonging to the cell sigma in V, where sigma itself is not completely inside UT. Okay. So we claim that there exists S equal to sum, S depends upon T positive, such that if any cell sigma of W intersects US, then the entire cell sigma is contained inside UT. This is what you have to prove. The moment it intersects, it must be, whole thing must be contained inside. Combined with the earlier claim, this will then complete both the proofs. Okay, this is the step which is missing in both of them. Okay. So what we have to prove? There is some small s, sufficiently small, but positive, such that any cell sigma of W intersects the small neighborhood US, then the entire sigma is contained inside UT. Okay, we have fixed T. What is T? We have fixed in all these, namely 0 less than T less than epsilon by 4. Any T, we have proved this one. But that itself doesn't prove the continuity. Now, fixing a T, we will claim that there is a smaller S, okay, such that if an element of a sigma belonging to W intersects US, then it must be contained in UT in a larger one. If it comes so close, smaller, then it must be inside that one. That is the whole idea. So, if this is not the case, what happens? Just take the negative of this one. what happens? That means that there exists a sequence ni converging to infinity such that even if it 1 by ni, it will not satisfy this property. As any small number, it doesn't satisfy. That is the meaning. Okay. So there is a sequence ni converging to infinity such that cells sigma I in W, sigma I intersection U 1 by n is non-empty, yet sigma intersection, the complement of this is also non-empty. It is not contained inside UT. Take the complement, it is still non-empty. In particular, this implies that the diameter of sigma I is bigger than T by 2. Okay? For all large ni, because this sigma intersection is very small, it has come, but the UT is still there. So I can check ni to be less than ti by 2, then 1 by ni less than ti by 2, then this will happen. Okay, in particular, this implies the diameter sigma I is bigger than t by 2 for large ni. If m is an integer such that t by 2 is bigger than 1 by m, this means that all sigma I are inside Wm, which has a positive distance from x, say delta. If I is such that 1 by ni is less than delta, this will contradict the choice of sigma intersection 1 by n is empty. Okay, I repeat this part. Okay, so what we have done? Suppose for each sigma I, sigma intersection this one is non-empty. Okay, you choose ni large enough, okay, then sigma I is, the diameter of sigma I will be bigger than T by 2 for large ni. Okay. Now take, if m is an integer such that this T by 2 is bigger than 1 by m. Okay. This means that all sigma j, I should say this is 1 by 2 power m. Okay, this must be 2 power m, because these Wms are belonging to our lattice points. Then inside Wm, which has a positive distance from x, say delta. Okay, this means that all sigma i's are inside Wm, okay, which has a positive distance from x, say delta. Okay, remember all these UIs are UN, UIT, etc. I am writing, they are balls of centered at X, one single point. At a point, that point we are doing all this. Our notation is this UT. What is UT? UT is BT of X. Okay, U1 by N is B1 by NX. That's the meaning of that. Okay, if I is such that 1 by ni is less than delta, but then sigma intersection this will not be. So that's a contradiction. Next time we shall prove one of the very important things that we had raised earlier from using this one, namely that the fundamental group of any topological manifold is countable. Okay? So that is the homotopical aspect of this one. That's what we get. Retraction is already some kind of homotopy, though we have not proved that it is a deformation retraction. Okay, that's not needed. Okay? So let us stop here. Thank you.